Good morning. We are Luke and Brandon Speckman. We're honored to lead the New York City Church.
Yes, today we actually have a very special treat for you. Our dear brother, Jonathan Davis from the Connecticut region, will be preaching the word today.
And if you like our service, please do like and subscribe to our channel.
Yes, hope you enjoy.
Water you turned into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. There's none like you. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. There's none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, into the darkness we shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. There's none like you. Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? Then what can stand against? Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome power, our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other, our God is healer, awesome in power, our God. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand against? Then what can stand against? Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other, our God is healer, awesome in power, our God. Our God is greater, our God is stronger, God, you are higher than any other, our God is healer, awesome.
Oh, yeah.
Good morning, church. My name is Luke Speckman. This is my amazing wife, Brandon. I'd like to read a scripture in Psalm chapter 95, beginning in verse 1. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is a great God, the great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth. The mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his. He made it, and his hands formed the dry land. You know, today we're going to come before the Lord and worship. And it is an amazing time when we have our virtual service. And I do hope that you've enjoyed the virtual services. But one thing that I've noticed is that when people see the singing on the television, they don't have the same mindset as if you were in person fellowshipping and singing with your brothers and sisters. And so I want to give a special charge to everybody out there that when it's time to sing to the Lord, that we sing to the Lord. We realize that it is not just simply words on a television or on a phone, but that we are actually singing to the Lord our God, who made the mountains, who formed the seas, and made the dry land. And now I'd like to have Brandon share.
Well, this is a very warm welcome to the women who are out there. I'm so excited that you've chosen to come and worship our God with us today. I love this passage. Come, sing for joy to the Lord. So even just thinking right now for the women, are you filled with joy, with the opportunity to come and sing to our God? To understand that we're to come before him with thanksgiving. Are we grateful this morning? So for the women who are out there, I don't care if you're in your pajamas or just woke up, sleep in your eye, hair mess up, it doesn't matter. Who you're coming before right now is the Lord our God, the one who gives us salvation and freedom in his son. So I just want to encourage you to wake up, shake it off, and to realize who you come before and have a great big smile on your face and sing as though you're singing to God himself and enjoy the rest of today's service. So glad you're with us this morning.
Yes, my wife and I live here in Manhattan, and two of our children are still below 18 and live with us. My daughter Bridget and my other daughter Landon. And our son Malik is in college, and because of the COVID-19 situation, he came back and he's living with us also. And so each week, the five of us get up and we stand up and we sing. Last week, I especially enjoyed the song, There is a God, He is Alive. And I stood up and directed it and recorded us singing it, and it was awesome. I just felt like I was part of the fellowship, and we were just able to praise God. And so I do hope that today you really have that same feeling, that you're not just there listening. It's just not entertainment, but this is worship of a very Lord, our Creator. And with that, we want to welcome you to the New York City International Christian Church. Let's go to God in prayer. Father God, thank you so much for this amazing opportunity to come before you in worship. We're so grateful that we have technology that even though we can't come together physically, we can still have great tools to assist us in fellowship and in worship. And Father, I do pray that we are humbled as we do come before you this morning. We love you so much. We pray for your hand of protection over all of us and keep us healthy. Father, we love you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Enjoy the rest of the service. Good morning to our church family here in the tri-state area, as well as our friends and family tuning in globally. Thank you so much for joining us. My name is Kiana Davis, and today I'm bringing you good news from our SAGES World Sector. So for those of you who don't know, SAGES stands for South Asian Gulf and Eastern States.
And that includes all of the churches that we have in those geographic areas. So that includes Syracuse, New York. We have our church here in the tri-state area. We have Boston, New Hampshire, Atlanta, and multiple churches throughout Florida. And then, of course, in South Asia, we do have New Delhi and Chennai, India, as well as Kathmandu, Nepal. Many of you know Raja and Debbie Rajan, who oversee our churches in India. And today we have a quick video clip from them updating us on all of the good news happening in India, as well as a sobering impact of what it's like living in India with COVID-19. So if you have any distractions going on right now, please put them down, put them away, and tune in to this video. Please enjoy.
Hey, we bring you greetings from New Delhi, India. And Debs and I, we are so excited to share a few of the things that are happening over here in New Delhi and also around India and in Kathmandu, Nepal. One of the best news we have is in 19 days, we had 16 people get baptized here in India. And our goal was 20, but we made 16 here and then two in Nepal. So in about 19 days, we had about 18 baptisms. And this was before the coronavirus, thing started and we had to be, we were under lockdown and things like that. But God is doing amazing things. One of the best news is Chennai had about three baptisms. And three of them were from campuses. Mm-hmm. And so one of them is a guy called Abraham, who's completed he's doing his master's in physics. Incredible guy, wants to do great things for God. Also, we had a great woman in Nepal got baptized, and her name is Neera. Mm-hmm. And she's an incredible woman. Roger tells me that she reminds him about the Samaritan woman in John chapter 4, who kind of figured out her life was a mess, and she goes back and tells the whole town about how awesome God is, and she got to invite a ton of people to come and visit the church. A few more news from Chennai and from Bangalore. Yes.
Oh, okay. I want to share about Sherry, who's a teen, who's 17 years old, who got baptized in Bangalore. Now, Sherry's parents separated, and because of the separation, she had to discontinue her studies. But I really appreciate her heart because she never gave up and kept coming to the church. Every single day she would come to pray with the Jayashree's daughter Reena, and she fought with her parents, struggled so hard to get permission because she's 17, and she got permission from her father and her mother, and she got baptized, and she helps out with the Down syndrome children. So I'm so proud of her. And back here in Delhi, we have Anyam, who got baptized. He's finished his bachelor's in electronics and communication in engineering, and now is pursuing his Indian engineering services. And he was brought by dear sister Lynn, who Anyam was her senior in college. And Anyam had to really wrestle with all the traditions back home and fight through it with scriptures, and he got baptized here in Delhi. And the other person that I really want to share about is another teen in Delhi, and her name is Christina, and she had to go through a lot of problems at home. She lives in a very abusive family, and she lives with a mother and a stepfather, but to see her heart of wanting to be right with God, and she really felt the love of the disciples in the church, and she really wanted to be part of the family, and she got permission from both her parents, and now she is a sister in Christ, and she's such a fired up and joyful sister, and so proud of her.
Awesome. Amen. Well, just want to give an update of what is happening with the corona issue here in Delhi and India. Yeah. We are under a lockdown. So Delhi has been under lockdown since
19th of March.
Mm-hmm. Now, when we say lockdown over here, people cannot, go out. You can't loiter on the streets. Our beaches are not open. And so if the police finds you outside, they're going to thrash you. I mean, they have walking around with sticks. They will hit you. They'll beat you up if they see you, going out, just hanging around with friends and things of that nature. So they stop cars, they stop bikes, and you can see videos up where people are getting beaten by the cops. Yes. So that's intense over here. But with the disciples, it's a little different. I mean, Debs will share more.
Especially we have 34 teens in Delhi, And the teens are the ones who are affected the most because they do not have phones and they have to depend on their parents for communication. So, you know, even the virtual devos or the services, I really appreciate the teens really striving hard to, you know, get some time, get a phone or maybe the neighbor, and they make every effort. They all come together, even though they are not allowed to go out, they sneak out, they come, and they, for at least two or three of them, join together over one phone and crowd around one phone, and, you know, they try to listen to the message and they try to keep in touch either with somebody else's phone. And I really, really appreciate the teens at this time. You know, even though some of them live in abusive families, it really is a problem keeping in touch. And they do not, many of them do not have internet connection. But to see their hearts of wanting to be faithful, and even the single women, married women whose husbands are not disciples, is really a struggle for them to be in touch, just to keep in touch. And it's, you know, with all this lockdown, it is really affecting many of their disciples just to be faithful. They're struggling so hard to be faithful and to be connected with the disciples. But I'm appreciated. I really love the hearts of all the leaders wanting to be in touch with their disciples and making every effort just to keep each other faithful.
Yeah. And the disciples who don't have food to eat, we had to provide some rationing had to be done because simply don't have food. And so it's been a challenge, but the spirit of the disciples is incredible. Just the leadership in Delhi, across India, it's a giving nature. Mm-hmm. They want to help, they want to give the best and make sure the disciples are kept faithful.
Yeah.
We are grateful for all the support we get from the US and New York Church. We are so grateful that, you know, you guys are sacrificing and providing. I know the missions are coming up for you guys, and probably it's already on, but we are so grateful for all your sacrifices you do that is keeping us going over here so that we in turn can give it out to our own disciples.
Yes.
Thank you so much for being with us in spirit. We love you guys, and we cannot forget being there last year.
We
love you.
Thank you
so much. Take care.
Yes.
I don't know about you, but when I see those updates and see the photos, it just brings everything that we do to life. And I'm so grateful to be a part of the Sages World Sector. Please be keeping all of the churches in the Sages World Sector in your prayers, and please enjoy the rest of our service.
Good morning, church. Please turn with us in your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 4. My name is Ernest Baker, and this is my amazing wife, Shannon Baker. And my wife will be sharing what the cross means to her today for the communion message. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12. For the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of him to whom we must give account.
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning, church. Thank you for this opportunity to share for communion today. As my husband just read, the word of God is alive and active. And I hear that, I know that, but when I think about what's really been my reality these last few days, couple of weeks, week or so, whatever it's been, I don't even know, it feels like, my reality has been the opposite. I don't feel like it's been alive and active. And I mean, of course, there's the obvious show of the streets being much more quiet, especially in New York City. No cars, nobody riding the train, no people out on the streets. There's that obvious show, but then there's what's happening on the inside of my heart. And the quarantine has really exposed really where I've been, and I've felt the opposite, more like dead and inactive. And it's really been the most uncomfortable thing, because I didn't know this is where I was at, or this is where I could get. And so currently, you know, being in this state has really forced me to ask some questions about myself spiritually. How long have I been dead and inactive? What was the thing that killed me, you know, or is killing me? And it's, you know, who else am I affecting in this way? Am I affecting anyone in this way? Is my husband affected? Is my daughter affected? And, you know, after asking myself some questions like that and really just thinking about my own personal life, I realized that God has used this time, this quarantine, to really expose my thoughts and my attitudes. And they've come out and shown themselves in my home, in my relationship with my husband, my marriage. I have not built him up all the time as the word says to do. I have shown impatience with my daughter, who's not even 1 year old yet. And it's disgusting, it's disturbing, and it hurts my heart to think that I can be so dead and inactive spiritually. So right now, the cross to me is being exposed. That's what the cross to me is. It's being exposed before God, the good, the bad, the ugly, and not just what's on the outside or what people can see, because right now, no one can see anything. I'm not outside on the streets. I'm not being distracted and stimulated by my different activities. I'm in my home, and really, I can't hide from God. That's who sees me the most clearly all the time. And with that, I understand that it's only God's word that is alive and active that is going to make me alive and active. But the only way that it can do that is if I am exposed and I see myself as I am, as God sees me. So the cross to me is being exposed and dealing with what God's word has exposed in me and dealing with it with God's word. So thank you so much for allowing me to share.
Let's go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for giving Jesus to us on the cross when it should have been us. As we take the bread that represents Jesus' body, I pray, Lord, that we consume it, and reflect on how it was broken for us. As we take the cup that represents Jesus' blood shed for us, I pray, Lord, that we remember Jesus. Examine ourselves at this time and understand how we need to be more like Christ. I pray this all in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Good morning, church. My name is Nick Infantino, and my wife and I lead the New York City region of the church. And this morning, I have the privilege of giving you the contribution message. Now, of course, this is a time in our service when we give back to God financially. So if you have your Bibles out, please turn with me to Luke chapter 12. Now, we know that with the pandemic happening, there's been a lot of changes happening in all areas of our life. And financial changes are definitely one. But this morning, I want to give you a little silver lining on some of these changes. And let me start off with just some things outside of the financial realm. Just our meetings and our work, right? Everything is now virtual. We all get to work from home now. And this may have some negatives, but it may have some pros as well. It may have some of that silver lining. I mean, we get to work in our dress clothes for some of us. We get to work kicking our feet up on our couch. We get to watch service from the luxury of our living room, perhaps eating our eggs and bacon while worshiping God. I mean, that's pretty awesome right there. Another thing is we've had a lot of changes in how we spend our time in general, right? And this is a bad thing for a lot of us. We're cooped up in the house. But again, silver lining there. For some of us, it's allowed us to get a lot more experimental in our cooking, right? I've cooked so many more dishes, my wife and I, since we've been in the lockdown. So that's been great. Some of us, it gave us an opportunity to have awesome, clean homes because we spend so much more time in our rooms and in our own space that I'm sure that right now, as you look around your own living room, it's probably spotless, right? That's silver lining. Yeah, hopefully that's the case. Amen. And another thing is our spending habits, right? Now, I know for me, I've saved a lot of money on not using the subway and the MTA. I'm definitely not riding that thing during this time, that's for sure. So that saved me a lot of money. And I also saved a lot of money not eating out and with entertainment and this and that as you go around the city. But I will tell you this, my grocery bill has gone up about 3 times as much. So, you know, that might balance out a little bit. But these financial challenges, these financial changes, not only the spending, but perhaps we're tempted to look at some other negative aspects of it, because the fact is some of us have some real challenges. Many people have lost jobs during this time. Many have suffered pay cuts or now on unemployment. And this is a very real challenge. And we can be tempted to look at these things and see only the negative. Well, again, this morning, I want to bring you the silver lining. So here in Luke chapter 12, in verse 15, the Bible reads, Jesus speaking, he says, "Watch out, be on guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions." And he told them this parable. "The ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest. He thought to himself, 'What shall I do? I have no place to store all my crops.' Then he said, 'This is what I'll do. I'll tear down my barns and build bigger ones. And there I will store my surplus of grain. And I'll say to myself, you have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy. Eat, drink, and be merry.'" Pretty nice little setup he's got there. He's feeling pretty good. "But God said to him, 'You fool, this very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared for yourself? This is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves, but is not rich toward God.'" So right here, we see God's perspective on our worldly wealth. And he reminds us to not store up for ourselves on earth. And we understand now more than ever, with the pandemic, life is not about building our own little empire, creating our own little circle of wealth, and finding our security and our comfort in that. It can be wiped away in an instant. And now we have to look at where our priorities are really at. And I think this is the silver lining. This situation that we're in allows us to take a look at where our hearts are actually at. Is our comfort and our security rooted in our earthly wealth, or is it on God, who really is in control of all of these things? And we know how unstable our earthly possessions and wealth actually is now. And God reminds us of where our true stability comes from. Now, look just at the bottom of this same chapter, right past the verses on "Do not worry" in chapter 12. The Bible reads in verse 32, "Do not be afraid, little flock, for your Father has been pleased to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give to the poor. Provide purses for yourselves that will not wear out, a treasure in heaven that will never fail, where no thief comes near, no moth destroys, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So, church, this morning as we give, let's check our hearts and make sure that they're invested in the kingdom of heaven and not our earthly wealth. With that, let's go to God in prayer. Dear Father God, we thank you, Lord, for providing for all of our needs and giving us opportunities like this to be shaken up out of our comfort of our earthly possessions and attachments, our statuses, our bank accounts, God, and to see what really matters. God, I pray that we can take this time to get our hearts right about giving back to you, that we can trust in you fully, God, knowing that you are our shepherd, you are our father, and in you alone is our comfort and security and joy found. God, I pray that we give wholeheartedly today with total trust in your plan for each of our lives, God, and knowing that you will see us through this time, God, and you truly provide everything we need and not ourselves. We love you, God. We thank you for this time. We pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
My name is Salma Banu, and I'm a one-year disciple, and right now I'm in a leading a church in Bangalore. Kingdom people like Raja Bro, who trusted and gave a responsibility to me to lead the ministry, that was the greatest happiness for me, to feel that as a woman, he didn't even thought that she can't take care, but he had faith on me to give me a responsibility leading Bible talk and all, and discipling 4 to 5 girls under me. I'm basically from Muslim background. So when I came to know about Jesus, I understood that where I was standing as a Muslim, and I understood what is a real God. And when I had a Bible study, the main thing which has impacted me more is a cross study, where God has gone through so much of pain because of my sins, because of my iniquities, where God has suffered. That impacted me more to be a disciple to a God. Chennai to Delhi, I went as a single. From Delhi to Bangalore, we came as a married. In the kingdom and leading the church with him, it's a really great joy, because being a young Christian, I learn a lot from him, and God is the happiest thing in my life, that I'm enjoying the life with the John. Coming from Muslim background, I'm grateful to be a woman because I have a lots of freedom over here. Being in a kingdom, a woman is not treated differently. Where you see in a Muslim background, women will be treated differently. Women will be oppressed more, but here I have all the freedom to do as a woman. Even till today, I'll be having a persecutions from my family. It's because my father is a very strong Muslim. And even he told me that he went and asked to the Muslim people what they should do if a own child converts into a Christianity. That means a child is dead for them. So when I came to into the God, when I came to know about Jesus, when I became a disciple, they totally cut down talking to me. No matter how much persecution comes, I need to stay strong with the God, then only I can reach the heaven. Then only I can reach out to the people and show people that he is a true God.
I want to save as many as souls I can. Mainly, I want to save a Muslim souls.
Yeah, I really want every woman to be a great leaders where they can lead many women under them. Not just being like a disciple, not just being in the church, but being a great leaders in the kingdom. Where they can change this whole world ups and down.
Just want to say thank you, a big thank you to New York for sending you guys over here.
Yeah.
But also to the brothers, sisters out there in the entire United States, because that helps us, you know, to move forward. So thank you so much for that.
Yeah. Really, really want to thank you so much, and I really appreciate everything that you're doing. It really means a lot for every soul that we save. It really matters. So thank you so much for your hearts. Thank you for your sacrifice. Very, very grateful for all that you guys are doing. And we are so grateful that we can be so focused and we don't have to worry about anything, that we can help as many as possible. It's because of your sacrifice. And so we thank you very much for that.
We in the water, way in the water, children, way in the water, God's gonna trouble the water. I'm singing way in the water, I'm singing way in the water, children, way in the water, and God's gonna trouble the water. Trouble the water.
They look like the people that Moses led.
God's gonna trouble the water.
Now see the people dressed in gold.
God's gonna trouble the water.
They look like the disciples of Christ untold.
God's gonna trouble the water.
That's why we're singing,
waiting.
My name is Jonathan Davis, and I have the pleasure of leading the Connecticut region alongside my wife, Kiana. Please turn your Bibles with me to 1 Peter chapter 1. It's awesome to be able to be here this morning to preach the word. You know, the end of a story, if you don't know, it's called a denouement. This is the point of the story where after everything is concluded, after the climax, all of the pieces come together. All of your questions are answered. All of the matters of the story, the movie, the narrative, everything has come to be resolved. You see, most people, when it comes to even movies or TV shows, they desire a happy ending. Now, what happens in a movie, what happens at the end, you want to know that everything is going to work out with that character, that protagonist, right? You know, if you're anything like my wife, you know, who hasn't really seen many movies. What happens is when I show her a new one and the movie starts to get intense, you know, that the music is playing, the character, the protagonist is in danger. She's like, well, hey, babe, is everything going to be okay? I was like, oh, you just got to watch. Well, is this person going to survive? Kiana, you got to watch the movie. Well, is Darth Vader Luke's dad? Like, you understand that I'm your father. That's a well-known quote. Like, that's what that means. It's like, that's what that means? Okay, well, amen. Well, babe, John, are they going to get back together? Well, Kiana, you just gotta watch the movie and wait and see. Fine, I'm just gonna Google it. You see, when you watch a movie, the end result of the movie, the end result of the book, the story, it matters. The end result of the TV show, it compels you to watch more episodes. This concept makes me think of this scripture. Let's look in verse 8 of 1 Peter chapter 1. The Bible reads, "Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him. And are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your souls." You see, many of you watching have some form of faith. You have some form of faith in God, some form of faith in Jesus or in the Bible. You have started your spiritual journey. You know, we are not here this morning to talk about starting a spiritual journey. We are going to talk about the end result of it. You know, if you're like me, I have fallen and I have risen many times in my walk with God. But so we're going to really hone in and focus on the end result. The title of my lesson this morning is simply the end result. Let's look in Romans chapter 12. Point number one is the end result of change. And let's pick it up in verse 1. The Bible reads, "Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will." You see, as disciples, as Christians, we cannot conform to the pattern of the world. However, we need to renew our minds and therefore be changed, be transformed. You know, in Matthew 17, I'm sure many of you are familiar with this, is if you remember this scripture, Jesus takes James, John, and Peter on the mountain, and they meet Moses and Elijah. And the Bible describes Jesus as being transformed, that his appearance was changed. Now, the way that this is written, the same in Romans 12 in the Greek, that transformation is the exact same in Matthew 17. So you see the correlation here, that this is an actual transformation, that you are to be changed, that we should be changed by the renewing of our mind. This is an actual and full transformation. In Isaiah 53 verse 2, it says that Jesus had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him. Nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. But you see, in the transformation, you see who Jesus really is. The Bible in Matthew 17 describes him as that his face was like the sun, and that his clothes were as white as light. So I want you to think about this for a second. Imagine your biggest sin, your biggest struggle, or a trial, or a hardship. Imagine something that you are battling right now in this moment. And take a moment and just think about that for a second. Let it come in. What am I struggling with? What is something that's hard for me to overcome? And just take a quick moment. Now, imagine that thing right there in your mind. And imagine just, poof, it's gone. You aren't battling it any longer. Not that it was just taken away, but that you mastered it. Imagine that you overcame it. And it is no longer a struggle. What would your life look like now? How would you feel right now? In this moment, do you even believe that that could happen? That you can change? That you can be transformed? Do you believe that? You see, sometimes the circumstances around us, they're just uncontrollable. You see, you may just need to change your perspective. Now, don't focus on what you can't control. Focus on what you can control. what you can change. Now, the one thing that you can't change, you can change your heart. You can change your mind. You can renew your mind and therefore be transformed. There it is again. You see, we can't control what is happening in the world right now with the COVID-19. But you can change how you come out of it. You can change who you will be once it's over. You can come out of this closer to God than you've ever been. You can take this time and start mastering all the areas of your life. All those opportunities, all those areas, those struggles, those hardships. You can take the time and work on all of those. And then you can come out of this better than you've ever been. Stronger than you've ever been. It all begins with yourself. It all begins with looking in the mirror and myself. It begins with ownership. You know, this is an area of my life where over the last month, I did this. I looked in the mirror and I looked at myself and I was like, wow, what is going on? Why is this happening? What have I done? And I had to look at the people that I possibly hurt and I had to take ownership. And I had to apologize and I had to be real. And I had to look at my wife and say, you know what? I have neglected you. And I looked at it and I was like, you know what? I am here. And the outcome of where my life was going was nobody's fault but my own. It was nobody's fault but me. And I had to take a long, hard look. And I had to make those changes. And this sermon, this lesson, this is what I came up with. Like, this is what I realized that I needed to change for myself. So it is no one's fault. It's easy for me to say it's your fault. It's easy for me to say it's your fault. But it was harder for me to say, wow, this is because of me. Do you know what the first step in changing an addiction is? Admitting you have an addiction. Admitting that you have a problem. You know what the first step in changing sin in your life is? Admitting that you have sin and something that you're doing needs to actually change. You see, oftentimes we know that there's sin there, but we don't think that we need to change it. See, it's admitting that you actually have a problem and that you need to change it. You see, it's very true. Anyone, we can help each other all day long, but unless you want to change yourself, you'll never truly change. You have to go out there changing for yourself, changing for God. It's a lot harder to look in the mirror and just say, wow, I did that. I messed up. I am here, not because of anyone else. I am here because of me. That is harder to do. So it's easier for us to just blame it on everybody else. Let's look in Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5. I want to tell you a story. There was a time a few years ago where eating codfish was the most popular item to eat. As far as seafood goes. And it was very popular on the eastern states. And so when people would visit, they're like, oh, I want to get this. How do I get this to, you know, further west, to the central states? We want to share this with all the people that we live with, where we live. And so they decided, okay, let's ship out the fish. You know, we'll catch it, kill it, and we'll ship it out. So they got the fish to the western side by train. And when they got the fish, they cooked it up, prepared it the same way, and it was just mushy. There was no taste to it. And then so they're like, okay, well, how about this? Let's catch the fish. We'll put them in these tanks, and we'll ship them by train again, but we just won't kill them. We'll just leave them in water. And so they did it. They sent it across, and when they got the fish, they cooked it. It was still mushy. It was still lacking flavor. And so they're like, okay. And then one guy said, you know what? The natural predator of the codfish is the catfish. So what they decided, he said, hey, why don't we do this? Why don't we put all the codfish into the tank? And then we'll throw a couple catfish in there with them. And so they did that. And so on this whole journey from the eastern states to the western states, you have just the catfish just chasing all of the codfish around. And so when they finally got to the other side, they prepared and they cooked it, and it was amazing. The taste was there. It was flavorful. and favorable. Excuse me. Now, and everything was prepared the way that it was supposed to be. And it was awesome. Let's look in Romans chapter 3. Chapter 5, excuse me, in verse 3. Chapter 5, verse 3. The Bible reads, "Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance, character, and character, hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us." You see, oftentimes we're put in these situations where there are sufferings, there are trials, there are hardships. But you can either do one of two things. You can understand that, hey, this is my situation, and I'm going to learn how to live with it and master it and come out better. Or you can blame God for it. You can blame the people around you, and then you'll never be good. You'll just come out mushy and have no taste. But you see, if you take ownership for your situation and say, hey, this is the situation that I've been put in. You know what? God has allowed this great pressure to come into my life. This hardship, God has allowed it to happen. He allowed the COVID-19. God allowed that. So you can either blame him for it, or you can come out of this tasty. You can come out of this with great flavor, and you can be a better Christian, a better man, or a better woman than you've ever been in your life. You know, if you feel stuck, if you feel like, you know, you just don't know how to change, that you're just, you're lost. You know, I want to encourage you that and help you to understand that we are here to support you. We are here to help you out. We want to help you. Please reach out to us. If you click on the link below, you'll see a contact form. And please just reach out to us. Let us pray for you. Let us pray with you. Let us get into deep Bible studies with you and help you through this challenging time. If you are a member of our church, I want to encourage you. Do not just stay isolated. Reach out to someone. You know, I love reaching out to people that I'm close to. People that I know that want to hear me. And understand that we need to stay connected as brothers and sisters. Let's pray with each other. Let's look in Mark chapter 12, and we'll get into point number 2. Mark chapter 12. And let's pick it up in verse 41. Point number 2, the end result of sacrifice. Mark 12 in verse 41. It says, Jesus sat down opposite the place where the offerings were put, and watched the crowd putting their money into the temple treasury. Many rich people threw in large amounts, but a poor widow came and put in 2 very small copper coins, worth only a few cents. Calling his disciples to him, Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put more money into the treasury than all the others. They all gave out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in everything, all she had to live on." You know, when it comes to giving to God, you fall into one of 4 categories. One is you show up with empty hands and an empty heart. 2, you show up with full hands with an empty heart. 3, you show up with empty hands and a full heart. Or 4, you show up with full hands and a full heart. You see, I believe, however, at different times, you may fall into different categories depending on what's going on in your life. You see, empty hands and an empty heart, well, what does that look like? This one, I believe it looks like, and it could have other meanings, but it looks like you're just checked out. You know, like you're barely hanging on. You know, you're showing up, but you just don't know what's going on in your life. You're just being choked out. Well, now, when you show up with full hands and an empty heart, what does that look like? Well, it's giving at that point just becomes an obligation, whether it's missions or weekly giving. You see, most of our relationship with God at that point are just checkboxes. You know, these are the people who give out of wealth, not the heart. What about empty hands and a full heart? What does that one look like? Well, maybe we're having great quiet times. We're praying. We're in Bible studies. However, we miss a very crucial part of God's call, which is giving and sacrificing monetarily, giving and providing for the needs of God's people. You know, obviously the desired category is showing up with full hands and a full heart. If these are the categories that you're in, of course we want to be in the fourth category, but if you're in the other three, I want you to ask yourself, why? Well, why am I in this category? What's holding me back from coming to God with full hands and a full heart? What's pulling me away? It could be a number of different things. It could be even the COVID-19, where many of us were grabbing all of our wealth and we're just trying to hold it and store it up because out of fear. We want to store up for the winter, if you will. I want to challenge you with this. I want you to be open. I want you to be real this week. I want you to be open with your disciple, the person who mentors you, and just say, hey, this is where my heart is. I want you to be able to share openly what's going on. You see, if you hold it in, we won't know. If you're visiting, I would love for you to get connected with us. Find out the reason why we give. Find out the reason why we sacrifice. And I want all of you to understand this. Sacrifice is simply that. It is a sacrifice. A sacrifice will never be convenient. It'll never be easy. A sacrifice is hard. It's challenging. But God calls us to sacrifice because we need to have faith that God is going to take care of us. We need to give with our hearts. There is a saying that I like. I love very much. It's I don't know what I don't know. Which means I only know what you share. I don't know what you don't tell me. You see, I don't know what you aren't willing to share. I want to challenge you again. Be real. Be open. Share with us what's going on. And then let us help you out. Let us show you scriptures. Let us pray with you. Let us connect with you, getting Bible studies, and help you to understand that we should give with all of our hearts, with full hands and a full heart. Now, I want to take this time to lift up a brother in our region in Connecticut, Jesus Mendez. Jesus has been just a great joy since he came out here a few months ago. And he has supported us. He has done an amazing job just taking care of many of the brothers here in Connecticut. Now, it was interesting because his heart was that he needs to give to God. Now, I never asked him to do this. But he texted me and he said, hey, bro, I just gave. I won't say the amount. I just gave a certain amount of money. And it was a hefty sum. And my first reaction was, wow, how are you feeling? And he was like, I feel good. Because I realize that this is bigger than me. Now, Jesus is not going to get any assistance from the government. All of this is coming from the job that he's working now. But his heart and his mind was, you know what? This is bigger than me. I want to support God's kingdom. So Jesus, we thank you so much and we love you, bro. Let's look in 1 Peter chapter 1. And we'll get into point number 3. 1 Peter chapter 1. Point number 3. The end result of faith. Let's look in verse 3. The Bible reads, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. We'll stop right there. See, what's amazing is that you are promised something. Something spectacular. Something that will never spoil. Something that will never fade. And it's because of the sacrifice of our Lord Jesus Christ and the victory in his resurrection. And now we have the opportunity to have a home built for us in heaven, an inheritance that will last forever. You know, when we buy different things in the world, we always care about how long it would last. We always care. We look at a food item. Well, when's it going to spoil? How long do I have before I have to cook it? When you buy a smartphone, you want to know, well, what's my warranty? Is this thing always going to work? I want to make sure there will never be any problems. And I'm sure if you have a smartphone, you know that there's problems. Now, you want something. Can you guarantee that it will be there for me when I need it? You see, with Jesus, these aren't questions. With God, we understand that with God, we have the perfect guarantee. It is the only thing in the world, the only thing that you can think of, that there is a for sure, a perfect guarantee that you will receive the end result of your faith, which will be salvation in heaven. And that is something for all of us worth changing for. That is something worth sacrificing for. That is something where we put our faith in that, and we get to be connected to our Lord Jesus. And through Jesus, that is how you transform. Let's look in verse 6 of the same chapter. It says, in all this, you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. You see, we are in a challenging time. We are experiencing all kinds of trials right now. A lot of us are going through all kinds of different sufferings. But now is not the time to give up. Now is not the time to fold, to shut down, to lose heart. Now is the time to prove your faith to be genuine. Now is the time to latch on to Jesus. You know, this is a faith that is worth more than even gold. A faith that can move mountains. A faith that can change your very heart. Let's look in verse 8, and we'll close out right here. The Bible reads, though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Let me ask you this. Do you feel an inexpressible, glorious joy this morning? A joy that transcends worldly understanding. Do you experience that right now? Do you feel that? You see, no matter what trial you're going through, no matter the hardship, the suffering, you can find great joy in your salvation. You can find great joy in Jesus. I want to challenge you to level up this morning. I want you to take that area in your life that needs changing. Take that area in your life that's a weakness. That's something that you know, hey, I need to change this. And I want to challenge you to level it up. I want to challenge you to take a long, deep, hard look in the mirror and take responsibility for your own actions and make the changes that need to be made. Let's make sure we are praying and reading our Bibles every day. Let's make sure that we're drawing closer to God. Do not miss a day where you aren't spending time with your Lord. Let's come out of this pandemic closer to God than we've ever been before. Let's come out with even more fiery spirits. Let us show up before God with full hands and a full heart. Let's level up in our sacrificing. And let's take care of the needs of our local and our foreign churches. Let's take care of our brothers and sisters. Let's be honest this week. Let's open our hearts and let's be real. And let's share our hearts with each other. I want to leave you with this. If you have nothing, you have Jesus. If you have nothing going for you in your life, you have Jesus. If you are alone, you have Jesus. Isolated, you have Jesus. If you have no money, you have Jesus. If you are someone you know is sick, you have Jesus. If you're anxious or scared, you have Jesus. If you have failed, you have Jesus. You see, with Jesus, you have everything. With Jesus, you have enough going for you in your life. With Jesus, you are not alone. You are not isolated. With Jesus, you do not need money because you are very rich. With Jesus, you are comforted. With Jesus, you have peace. With Jesus, you have victory. And you will receive the end result of your faith, the salvation of your souls. And to God be all the glory. Amen.
Thank you so much for tuning in with us. We really hope you enjoyed today's service.
Yes, and we would like to welcome baby Cash Villanova. He is now home, safe and sound and healthy with mom and dad. Also, let's take a moment to welcome and introduce our new cyber evangelist and cyber women's ministry leader, Jonathan and Kiana Davis of the New York City Church, and to Aaron Vishakini of the Boston Church. We are so excited to see how God will continue to use you to truly propel the gospel throughout the invisible continent.
Please take a moment and fill out the link below so that we can stay connected and set up a personal Bible study or a prayer time. And as always, thank you so much to our healthcare professionals and essential workers for all of your service.
And with that note, we would like to please continue to request prayers for our dear sister, Shivanti Crawford. She's currently still in the hospital on a ventilator with COVID-19. Please keep her and Travis in your prayers. Thank you, family.
We'll see you next week. Luke Speckman here. It's my amazing wife, Brandon. And right now we have the great honor to appoint Jonathan and Kiana Davis, both cyber evangelists and cyber women's ministry leader. They're the dashing couple there with the yellow tie and the red dress. John, I have a scripture for you in Philippians chapter 2. This is Paul speaking about Timothy, but this is me speaking about you, Jonathan. Verse 20, I have no one else like him who takes a genuine interest in your welfare. For everyone looks out for his own interest, not those of Jesus Christ. But you know that Jonathan has proved himself because as a son with his father, he has served with me in the work of the gospel. And I've known Jonathan since he was about 15 years old. Brandon has known him since he was 8. He was a kingdom kid. And John and Kiana served tirelessly as the Connecticut region leaders. But we really needed desperately some help with our web presence. And Jonathan volunteered and immediately jumped in there and, you know, put in, you know, 12 hours just getting things up and running, creating new websites, and he just jumped in and really owned it. And so it's my great honor, Jonathan, to appoint you a cyber evangelist today, and I look forward to the day when I appoint you as an evangelist at a later date. I'll read you the other scripture on that date, but for the time being, we appreciate your service as cyber evangelist.
Yes. And for Kiana Davis, you know, Kiana was baptized April 2011 and literally has been by my side ever since. I'm so grateful. And that same scripture, I ditto for Kiana. But I wanted to share for you, Kiana, is do you see a woman skilled in her work? She will serve before kings and queens. And that is exactly who you are. Kiana has a bachelor's degree in communications, which has an emphasis on nonprofit organizations. Everything that Kiana does is excellent in every way. Her presence, her poise, her heart for excellence, absolutely. She is a woman who I trust with everything. And even this charge, I know that you're skilled at social media, you're skilled at photography, you're skilled at an eye for detail and excellence. And side by side with your husband, I know you guys are going to serve before kings and queens. And I'm so grateful. This is just the first appointment. for one soon to come. I love you, my dear, and welcome to Cyber Women's Ministry Leader. I love you. And I now pass it on to Mike Patterson of Boston.
Amen. Thank you, Brandon. Well, it's exciting. I'm excited to it's my honor today to appoint Aaron Bishakini as an evangelist in God's kingdom. If you can wave, Aaron, so everyone can see you. He's the sharp young man with the blue tie there. The Bible says in Titus chapter 3, verse 13, do everything you can to help Zenas, the lawyer. And Aaron can actually practice law in two different states, New York and California. And yet he gave all that up when Luke called him to go into the ministry. Salaries aren't exactly the same. So he's totally sold out for God and his kingdom. And he's become really personally a best friend. And I'm excited for you, brother. The movement's going to use your skills to be an attorney and to help out in those different ways. Aaron's been a godsend, especially during this pandemic. There's a passage I want to share with you, bro, in Exodus chapter 4. And I've shared this with you personally, but it really means a lot to me. In verse 15, Moses had said that he couldn't speak to the people. So how could he go and bring out God's laws? And in verse 15, it says, you shall speak to him and put words in his mouth. I will help both of you speak and will teach you what to do. He will speak to the people for you, and it will be as if he were your mouth and as if you were God to him. And so God chose Moses' brother, Aaron, to be his mouthpiece, to speak to the people. And bro, I feel like it's perfectly of God that we're together. I don't know anything about technology. I mean, our live services would be like me in my room holding my phone. It'd look really bad. And yet, I don't know how to speak, and you have been my Aaron, that's literally your name, to really bring out this message to the world. And you've taken the church to new heights. You've helped clean up the persecution online to make our church attractive to the world. The light is really shining so bright. He travels all the way from New Hampshire to Boston to work with the song leaders. There's so much you do, and so much I could share. And I really just want to lift you up and say it's my honor today, and I'm so proud of you. You've really become one of my best friends, and I hope that today is very special, because it's going to be an incredible thing for God's kingdom.
to you, New York, New York, New
We want to thank you so much for watching. We really hope you enjoyed today's service.
We want to take.
I was 25 at the time, and he was like, "Well, I was 23." He was like, "Well, that's, or yeah, I was 25." He was like, "That's stupid. That's not good." And I can't say stupid on a recording.
That was terrible. The whole thing was just terrible. Okay, I can take it from here, though, because we can cut this part out and then keep going.
Yeah, as long as we don't get confused.
Okay, let's just start again.
That was awesome.
I messed up a couple of times. I was like, you know, the pin dropped.
I know, I heard.
I was like, I paused and I was like, I'll just keep going.
Thank you so much for watching. We really hope you enjoyed today's service.
Yes, we would like to take a moment.
Good morning to our friends and family tuning in. Nope.
He's able to breathe.
I need some water.
Okay, got it. Right now. This is it. Right here. Please don't use this on the bloopers, okay? I know you're thinking it.
I'm going to.
No!
Enjoys our please enjoy our service.
All right.
Aye, elkom wa ute ave uge usne.
Anything else you want to say?
I may Iana K. Davis hey. Avis day. You're not recording any of this, are you?
I am.
Oh, okay.
Come look at it.
Elkom wa ute ave uge usne of the iTray 8-stay area. I ingre uye udge uzne umfre India from Ajare and Ebste Abajane. I can't say that one.
Yeah, what, the lock is not working.
See,
right.
I told you.
I don't know why.
We'd like to thank you for watching.
Oh, wait, we gotta start again. Sorry, I was like doing this.
Okay.
Okay. All right, here we go.
Okay.
Blah, blah, blah. You can't laugh. That destroys the whole moment of letting it out.